Welcome, all of you, to our Maundy Thursday worship service. Tonight begins a very special night of worship, which really doesn't end until Easter morning. So you will notice tonight's worship service seems very strange and out of order, but this is the beginning of a three-day worship service. Now, tomorrow night at 6:30, we won't be here. We'll be at St. Stephen's. And on Easter morning, we will be in our respective churches. But we begin our worship tonight with an opening hymn. Please stand as you are able. You may be seated. Tonight I would like to talk about one last character from our Bible as we come to the close of our Lenten journey this year. Now, this character was not an ancestor of Jesus like all our other Wednesday evening worships were, Tamar, Rahab, Bathsheba, Ruth, and Mary. No, tonight I want to talk about one of the disciples, a person that Jesus consciously chose, someone Jesus invited and welcomed onto his team, into the inner circle. Judas. Jesus chose Judas because he saw greatness in him. And Judas chose to follow Jesus because Judas saw greatness in Jesus. So what happened? Very little is known about Judas Iscariot. It's as if the church just wanted to wipe him off the record like he never existed. But we can make some educated guesses with what little information we have. Some scholars believe that Judas had been a member of a group of Jews called the Zealots. Now, just like Christians have a wide variety of denominations, just within the Lutheran denomination, we've got Wisconsin Synod, Missouri Synod, NALC, ELCA, and then of course there's the Catholics, the Baptists, the Methodists, the Presbyterians. You can see there's a wide variety. So too, the Jews also had different groups whose beliefs differed from one another in much the same ways that Christian denominations do. So for Jews, some of the groups you might be more familiar with are the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the scribes. Now they believed that they needed to follow the letter of the law in its absolute fullest. They also believed that they needed to work with the Roman government so that they could practice their faith safely. Then there were a group of Jews called the Essenes, and they simply tried just to remove themselves from the world and practice their very strict, austere faith out in the wilderness. It was believed that John the Baptist was an Essene. But then there were the Zealots. The Zealots were a more radical group of Jews whose mission was to bring down the Roman rule in big military fashion. Now, Jesus moved freely amongst all of these Jewish groups. He just didn't tolerate others with different opinions. No, he actively went out and sought them, welcomed them, included them, and invited them into his circle. You see, Jesus desired to engage in differing opinions. Now, Judas probably saw Jesus acting in such scandalous ways, according to the law, as far as the Pharisees, Sadducees, and scribes interpreted it, that it would be very easy for Judas to assume that Jesus was a zealot. So when Jesus refused to act like a big, powerful military leader destroying the Roman rule, Judas perhaps thought Jesus might need a little poking and prodding. Perhaps if Jesus was just pushed a little bit, pushed to the brink of death, maybe then, at the very last second, Jesus would fight back. Jesus would lash out and destroy those hated Romans in apocalyptic fashion. Judas was so determined to do this, so zealous, that his way was the right way, that Judas was willing to push Jesus' life to the brink of death, never realizing what could happen. Judas wanted this victory, and with good reason. Those Romans were horrible to the Jews. And Judas wanted this victory so badly that he could not stop himself, even if it went against God's plan, even if it was not Jesus' mission. The horror that Judas felt Once he realized this, once he realized all that he was responsible for putting into motion, it was just more than he could bear. And as we read in the scriptures, he went out and hung himself. There was once a fiction book, and again, I want to emphasize that word, fiction book. A book I read once where Jesus and Judas were having a conversation about the events that were going to unfold at the crucifixion. And Jesus said to Judas that Jesus would rather face his own destiny than to have to go through what Judas was about to. Wow. What compassion and understanding Jesus had for Judas. I don't think I have to tell you this, but Jesus was no dummy. Jesus knew that Judas was going to betray him. Jesus knew it all along. And yet Jesus still saw greatness in Judas and invited him to join his inner circle. Jesus used Judas's misguided plans to fulfill scripture. What does this say about our own misguided plans? In just a few minutes, I will be sharing a gospel reading with you. And when you do hear it, notice that Jesus washed Judas's feet as if Jesus, the Lord of all, was Judas's servant. Because indeed Jesus was. Jesus came to serve all people, even the ones who make terrible mistakes. And notice also in the scripture I'm about to share with you that Jesus gave Judas the bread of that very first Holy Communion. Jesus welcomed Judas to the table, knowing full well what was about to happen that night. Jesus loved Judas. Jesus could see deep into Judas's soul and saw not his actions, but the child whom God created and adored. This is what love looks like. Is there any more powerful example of love in action than Jesus's relationship with Judas? My sisters and brothers, this is the same love that God has for us as well. Let that soak into your very bones this holy time of year. Realize how deeply, unconditionally, and eternally you are loved. This is the good news of Jesus Christ. Amen. In this Lenten season, we have heard our Lord's call to intensify our struggle against sin, death, and the devil, all that keeps us from loving God and each other. This is the struggle to which we were committed to at our baptism. God's forgiveness and the power of the Holy Spirit to amend our lives continue to be with us because because of God's love for us in Jesus Christ, our Savior. Within the community of this church, God never wearies of giving peace and new life. In the absolution of sin, we receive forgiveness from God, and this absolution we should not doubt, but firmly believe that thereby our sins are forgiven by God in heaven, for it comes to us in the name and by the command of our Lord. We who receive God's love in Jesus Christ are called to love one another, to be servants to one another as Jesus became our servant. It is, however, in Holy Communion that the members of Christ's body participate most intimately in his love. Remembering our Lord's Last Supper with his disciples, we eat the bread and share the cup of this meal. Together we receive the Lord's gift of himself and participate in a new covenant, a new promise, which makes us one with him. The Eucharist is the promise of the great banquet we will share with all the faithful when our Lord returns, the culmination of our reconciliation with God and with each other. Let us confess our sins. How is it that people will recognize us as followers of Jesus? Simply by how we treat one another. Let us confess how we have not loved as Christ loves us. Too often, Holy One, we forget to love you, even a little bit, much less with all our heart, mind, strength, and soul. Too easily we forget to love our neighbors. Instead, we build higher and higher walls between us. Too quickly we forget your call to servanthood, preferring the luxuries and applause of the world. Forgive us, O God. Bring us to your table of grace and hope, where we will be healed. Fill us with your steadfast love. Lift us to our feet so we may follow Jesus into the ministry of serving and loving others. Hear the cries of your people, merciful God, for the sake of the one who stretched out his arms on the cross to redeem your people and reconcile your whole creation, Jesus Christ our Lord. You are forgiven. You are given a new chance. Now go and share that peace with one another. For right now, we'll just share it amongst those who are here with us. Please stand and share the love and the peace of God with one another. You may be seated for some special music.
Search me, O God, and know my heart today. Try me. thoughts, I pray. See if there be some wicked way with me. Cleanse me from every sin and set me free. I praise thee, Lord, for cleansing me from sin. Fulfill thy word and make me pure within. Fill me with fire where once I burned with shame. Grant me my desire to magnify thy name. Lord, take my life and make it wholly thine. Fill my poor heart with thy great love divine. Take all my will, my passion, self, and pride. I now surrender, Lord, in me abide. O Holy Ghost, revival comes from thee. Send a revival, start the work in me. Thy word declares thou wilt supply our need. For blessing now, O Lord, I humbly plead.
The Lord is with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Eternal God, in the sharing of a meal, your Son established a new covenant for all people. In the washing of feet, he showed us the dignity of service. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit, these signs of our life in faith may speak again to our hearts, feed our spirits, refresh our bodies. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. You may remain seated as together we sing the hymn of the night.
Thank you. The first reading is from Exodus chapter 12, beginning with the first verse. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in Egypt, "This month is to be for you the first month of your year. Tell the whole community of Israel that on the 10th day of this month, each man is to take a lamb for his family, one for each household. If any household is too small for a whole lamb, they must share one with their nearest neighbor, having taken into account the number of people there are. You are to determine the amount of lamb needed in accordance with what each person will eat. The animals you choose must be year-old males without defect. You may take them from the sheep or the goats. Take care of them until the 14th day of the month, when all the members of the community of Israel must slaughter them at twilight. Then they are to take some of the blood and put it on the sides and tops of the door frames of the houses where they will eat the lambs. That same night, they are to eat the meat roasted over the fire, along with bitter herbs and bread made without yeast. Do not eat the meat raw or boiled in water, but roast it over a fire with the head, legs, and internal organs. Do not leave any of it till morning. If some is left till morning, you must burn it. This is how you are to eat it: with your cloak tucked into your belt, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. Eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover. On that same night, I will pass through Egypt and strike down every firstborn of both people and animals, and I will bring judgment on all the gods of Egypt. I am the Lord. The blood will be a sign for you on the houses where you are, and when I see the blood, I will pass over you. No destructive plague will touch you when I strike Egypt. This is a day you are to commemorate. For the generations to come, you shall celebrate it as a festival to the Lord, a lasting ordinance." The second reading is from 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 to 26. "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in the remembrance of me.' In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" Here end the readings. Please stand for the gospel.
The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 13th chapter. "Now before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart out of this world to the Father, having loved his own who were in this world, he loved them to the very end. And during supper, when the devil had already put it into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, rose from supper, laid aside his garments, and girded himself with a towel. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel with which he was girded. He came to Simon Peter, and Peter said to him, "Lord, do you wash my feet?" Jesus answered him, "What I am doing, you do not know now, but afterward you will understand." Peter said to him, "You shall never wash my feet." Jesus answered him, "If I do not wash you, you have no part in me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head." Jesus said to him, "He who bathed does not need to wash except for his feet, but he is clean all over, and you are clean, but not all of you." For he knew who was to betray him. That was why he said, "You are not all clean." When he had washed their feet and taken his garments and resumed his place, he said to them, "Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for so I am. If I then, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example that you should also do as I have done to you. Truly, truly, I say to you, a servant is not greater than his master, nor is he sent greater than he who sent him. If you know these things, blessed are you if you do them." Now, when he had gone out, Jesus said, "Now is the Son of Man glorified, and in him God is glorified. If God is glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself and glorify him at once. Little children, yet a little while I am with you. You will seek me. And as I said to the Jews, so I now say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. A new commandment I leave with you, that you love one another even as I have loved you. By this, all people will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." The Gospel of the Lord. Please remain standing for the prayers. You make a new covenant with your people, O Lord. Gather your church around word and table in love and promises as these holy days unfold. Open us to behold the mystery of our salvation. Merciful God, you give us our daily bread, fruit of the earth and work of human hands. Bless those who labor and tend to their crops, and those who prepare food for us. Strengthen us to advocate for food justice and a fair distribution of resources. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
You, our Savior and teacher, stoop down to us in servant love. Inspire national and local leaders with a renewed sense of public service. Increase in them a humility to serve with equity and fairness. Teach us to pray for our enemies. Merciful God, you incline your ear to us in every need. Befriend all who are lonely. Comfort those who grieve. Soothe any who are anxious. Console all who are distressed. Graciously tend to the hurts of your children who suffer in body, mind, and spirit, especially those we name either silently or aloud before you now. Merciful God, you inspire your people to praise in word, song, and art. We give thanks for artists whose gift enrich our church's worship. Kindle in us appreciation for all who beautify our worship space throughout the changing seasons. Merciful God, precious in your sight is the death of your faithful ones. We remember and give thanks for those who have died. Especially this night, we pray for Faye Laper. With them, we trust your promise to love your own until the end. Merciful God, we lift our prayers to you, O God, trusting in your steadfast love and your promise to renew your whole creation through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please remain standing as we play the offertory and receive our offerings. Let us pray our offertory prayer. O God of glory, receive these gifts and the offering of our lives. As Jesus was lifted up from the earth, draw us to your heart in the midst of this world, so that all creation may be brought from bondage to freedom, from darkness to life, and from death to life. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." And now, Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The congregation may be seated, and would the communion assistants please come forward. And now, may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen us and keep us in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, in a wonderful sacrament, you strengthen us with the saving power of your suffering and resurrection. May this sacrament of your body and blood so work in us that the fruits of your redemption will show forth in the ways we live. We pray this in your holy name. Amen. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from helping me from the words of my groaning? Oh my God, I cry by day, but you do not answer, and by night, but find no rest. Yet you are holy, enthroned on the praises of Israel. In you our ancestors trusted. They trusted, and you delivered them. To you they cried and were saved. In you they trusted and were not put to shame. But I am a worm and not a human, scorned by others and despised by the people. All who see me mock at me. They make their mouths wag at me. They shake their heads. Commit your cause to the Lord and let him deliver. Let him rescue the one in whom he takes delight. Yet it was you who took me from the womb. You kept me safe on my mother's breast. On you I was cast from my birth. And since my mother bore me, you have been my God. Do not be far away from me, for trouble is near and there is no one to help. Many bulls encircle me, strong bulls of Bashan surround me. They open wide their mouths at me and like a ravening and roaring lion. I am poured out like water, and all my bones are put out of joint. My heart is like wax. It is melted within my breast. My mouth is a dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue sticks to my jaws. You lay me in the dust of the earth. For dogs are all around me. A company of evildoers exercises me. My hands and feet have shriveled. I can count all my bones. They stare and gloat over me. They divide my clothes among themselves. And for my clothing they cast their lots. But you, O Lord, do not be far away. O my help, Come quickly to my aid. Deliver my soul from the sword, my life from the power of the dog. Save me from the mouth of the lion, from the horns of the wild oxen. You have rescued me. I will tell of your name to my brothers and sisters. In the midst of the congregation, I will praise you. You who fear the Lord, praise him. All of you offspring of Jacob, glorify him. Stand in awe of him, all of you offspring of Israel. For he did not despise or abhor the affliction of the afflicted. He did not hide his face from me, but heard when I cried to him. From you comes my praise in this great congregation. My vows I will pay before those who hear me. The poor shall eat and be satisfied. Those who seek him shall praise the Lord. May your hearts live forever. All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord, and all the families of the nation shall worship before him. For dominion belongs to the Lord, and he rules over the nations. To whom indeed shall all who sleep in the earth bow down? Before him shall bow all who go down to the dust, and I shall live for him. Posterity will serve him. Future generations will be told about the Lord and proclaim his deliverance to a people yet unborn, anything he has done.